guys, and welcome. This video is the Halloween special this year for Jensen Games. This year I'm going to be going through the history of the Silent Hill games. We are going to see just how far they have come. The series of games are all creepy and dark in tone, all based on the fictional town known as Silent Hill. The series was influenced by the literacy genre of psychological horror. So let's take a scary-ass journey together, guys, into the hellish world of Silent Hill and see what we can find, shall we? We start our journey at the very beginning in January of 1999 with the release of Silent Hill by Konami. Ah, Konami, back when they released actual video games that were good and not some sort of pinball machine. The first game came out on the PlayStation. The game was developed by Team Silent, which was a group out of Tokyo under the wing of Konami. The game uses the same style that all games pretty much used back then. I would compare it to early Resident Evil games, even though Resident Evil did not use the same exact environment type, but they were very similar in style. Due to the limitations of the PlayStation's hardware, the team had to find a good way around it. Back then, you really had to get creative sometimes to find a way around the hardware. But in this case, the limitations actually helped make the game what it was. Due to the limitations of the hardware, lots of fog and darkness was used to hide the graphical limitations and to make it look a lot better in the case of Silent Hill. It definitely worked well and added to the creepiness of the game. The first game follows Harry Mason as he searches around the town for his daughter. He soon discovers the horror behind the town and its true origin. You play through the game and you can actually get 5 different endings depending on how you play the game. There is also one joke ending which, well, the Silent Hill games are known for their weird joke endings. I would say the game has a similar playstyle to the Resident Evil games at the time, even though they are vastly very different at what they do and they try to convey. The game consists of combat, exploration, and lots of puzzles along the way. The game had the third-person camera angle, but it also threw in the occasional camera shift, which switched to different camera angles for dramatic effect in the pre-scripted areas. This was a change from the older survival horror games, which constantly shifted through the next fixed camera angle. Also, the game has no kind of HUD display. There's no display on the screen for ammo or health. Nothing but the game was present for you as you play. To me, this gave it more of a cinematic look. If you wanted to know how much ammo or health Harry had, you had to go into the menu and check it out yourself. It's worth noting if you had a DualShock controller, you could instantly tell if Harry was low on health by the heartbeat rhythm on the controller that could be felt with the vibrations. It let you pretty much know that you are only human and that you cannot take much before you had a game over. Enemies can make quick work of Harry if you're not careful, and he could be heard gasping and trying to catch his breath if you run him around too much. It lets you just see he's a mere man in a hellish world. You get the Signature Series portable radio early on in the game. If you know the series, you know the radio. It lets you know when the hellish monsters get nearby by playing a static sound over the radio. The closer they get, the louder it will be. It will alert you when all hell is about to break loose. You have to either avoid it, or you have to take on some Silent Hill monstrosity. The player can locate and collect maps of each area so that you can keep track of where you are going, which does help a lot. A little detail about this is you can only read the map if you have enough lighting. If you are in a dark corridor or something, you just can't read the map, which is a cool little detail. Each map shows the main points of interest on each one of them, and are certainly valuable commodities so that you're not just running around in the fog or darkness aimlessly. The map will give you a better approach to your surroundings, and you'll get lost a lot less. The darkness is a huge part of the game, more particularly the other world. The other world is pretty much a more messed up and nightmarish version of Silent Hill, which suddenly changes at the sound of the famous Silent Hill siren. You wouldn't think that Silent Hill could get much more messed up, but it certainly can. You get a flashlight early on in the game also, which is very important for your messed up Silent Hill journey. Even though you have a flashlight, it only provides visibility for a few feet in front of you. Navigating through the Silent Hill, it's a must. Like I said, the first game is mostly Harry just desperately trying to find his daughter after a car crash they had. You wake up and she is just gone. No explanation to why she just got up and vanished. I mean, it's not really something that you would really want to do in Silent Hill. You meet this cop along the way who tries to help you. You actually meet several people throughout the whole game. Eventually, it's inevitable that the darkness catches up with you and starts making the town more messed up and hellish. This is the other world I was mentioning earlier. It's a darker and more evil place that is more demonic and scary. Who could have imagined that Silent Hill could even be more freaking messed up? I'm not going to go all out and explain the whole tale to you because I believe if you haven't experienced it, you definitely should for yourself. The game doesn't hold up all that well, but it's still worth checking out to see how creepy the series began. Hell, I might even do a playthrough on this channel at some point. This game started being developed in 1996, and the team was put together and had failed all their previous projects, and they intended to leave Konami because they were not allowed to realize their own ideas and they just weren't compatible with the other teams. Hell, the team didn't even really know what to do with the Silent Hill game in the beginning. As time passed, the personnel and management of Konami lost faith in the game, and the team increasingly felt like outsiders. Eventually, the development staff decided to ignore the limits of Konami's plan and decided to make Silent Hill a game that would appeal more to the emotional side of the players, when Konami originally wanted a Hollywood-style approach. The team introduced a fear of the unknown with a darker tone and nature of the game. Because of the fog and darkness, the players really couldn't see what was around them. That was incredibly unnerving when you start to faintly hear your radio start to static, and you know something messed up is coming your way, but you didn't know what it was and exactly where it was coming from. It created a psychological type of horror. The plot was made to be vague and occasionally contradictory, to leave its true meaning in the dark and make players reflect upon it. Director Kichiro Toyama created the game's scenario while the programmer Hiroyuki Awaku wrote the text for the riddles. Toyama did not have much experience in horror movies, but he was interested in UFOs, the occult, and David Lynch movies, which all influenced the game heavily. The localization company Latina International translated the script into English. The town of Silent Hill was an interpretation of a small American community, imagined by the Japanese team. It was based on Western literature and films. It was also a depiction of an American town and European and Russian cultures. Artist Takeyoshi Sato corrected inconsistencies in the plot and designed the game's cast of characters. He was originally only given small tasks like font design and file sorting because of him being a younger employee. He also created 3D demos and presentations, and he taught the older members of the team fundamentals of 3D modeling. So even though he was younger, he showed a lot of them that age didn't mean anything. However, he wasn't really accredited for a lot of his work he did, mainly because he didn't have the same respect to Konami as much as the older employees did. Yes, I know, Konami is a dick. We've known this for a while though. Sato had the cojones to approach the higher-ups in the company with a short demo movie that he had rendered and threatened to withhold the knowledge of how to do it to the other staff members if he was not assigned to do 3D. Well, needless to say, they gave in to him and they allowed him to do the character designs. He gave each character their own characteristics, but he made Harry completely neutral, as he wanted to avoid forcing interpretation of the game on the players. Even though Sato did all the work and worked his ass off for the game in creating the character designs, his superiors still did not want to give him full credit on his work, and they intended to assign a visual advisor. So this guy did all this freaking amazing work, and they wanted to assign him an advisor? What the F, Konami? In order to prevent this from happening, Sato volunteered to create the full motion videos of Silent Hill all by himself. So over the course of 2.5 years, he basically lived in the development office, as he had to render the scenes after all the other co-workers had went home because he needed their computers. Sato estimated the game's budget at around $3 to $5 million. He said the team intended to make the game a masterpiece rather than a traditional sales-oriented game. They opted in an engaging story which would persist over time, much like the successful literature that had inspired from. The game debuted at E3 1998, where the presentation of the in-game scenes and movies gained much praise and much applause from the audience. This reaction persuaded Konami to allot more personnel and public relations initiatives to the project. Konami later showcased the game at a London trade show, and included a demo with its stealth game Metal Gear Solid in Japan. Another way that Silent Hill had set itself from the other games is the music soundtrack. The soundtrack for Silent Hill was composed by Akira Yamaoka, who requested to join the developmental staff after the original musician had left. In addition to the music, he was also in charge of the sound effect creation and audio mastering. Yamaoka didn't watch the in-game cutscenes at all. Instead, he used the visuals to create the music. The style was influenced by the Twin Peaks composer Angel Badalamenti. The game had a very different soundtrack from most games, which it really set itself apart from. It had cold, gritty, rusty, industrial music. When he presented the music to the team for the first time, they all thought it was a game bug and that it was broken. Yamaoka had to explain to the team that it was not a bug, but instead that it was intended to sound like that. The team finally quit objecting once he explained the reasoning behind his method of madness. In March of 1999, the album for Silent Hill was released as a soundtrack to the game in Japan, the 41st track on the CD. Yes, that's right. The game had a ton of tracks. The 41st track was composed by Rika Miranaka. After Yamaoka had approached her to create a piece of music for the game, she suggested to use bandoneons, violins, and a Spanish singer, and decided to make it a tango song. Before its release, Silent Hill had a tough time passing the censors outside of Japan. The Grey Child monster went through many design changes in the North American release and the European release. Originally, it was designed to resemble a knife-wielding nude child. It was deemed way too graphic, though, particularly because the player was allowed to kill them. Not really because the child was naked, really? The North American version featured a faceless gray larger version with a modified head. The European version was completely replaced altogether with another monster called the Mumbler, which appears later in the game in the North American release. Near the end of the European version, though, however, the gray child monsters can still be seen as transparent silhouettes. There was a radically altered version of the Silent Hill game that was released on the Game Boy Advance. It was called Play Novel Silent Hill, and was only released in Japan in 2001. It is a gamebook-style visual novel. Essentially, it's exactly what it sounds like, a retelling of Silent Hill through text-based gameplay. It occasionally confronted with big questions concerning what direction to take the character in, as well as puzzles, which were a big part of the original Silent Hill, so it did have nods to the original. After you completed the game once, you had the option of playing through again with Sybil as a second scenario, and then there was a third scenario available for download once you beat the second one. Wait, Game Boy Advance had a download feature? When the game was exhibited, Western critics were certainly not impressed with it and criticized it for its lack of soundtrack, which severely detracted from the horror factor that the game had before. I mean, come on, the soundtrack was paramount for the original. There was also a film adaptation titled Silent Hill that was released in 2006. It was based largely and loosely on the game, incorporating elements from the first game and also 2, 3, and 4 as well. Harry Mason was completely replaced with a female protagonist, Rose Da Silva, because it was felt that Harry had many qualities that were typically perceived as feminine. The film's soundtrack includes music composed by Yamaoka. Although critical reaction was mostly negative, the film was still a financial success and was praised by fans, especially for the visual aspect of the film. There was also a reimagining of the original Silent Hill titled Silent Hill Shattered Memories, and was released and developed by Climax Studios for the Nintendo Wii. The game was released on December 2008 for the Wii, and January 2010 for the PlayStation 2 and PSP. It mostly had positive reviews. It does retain the premise of the man searching for his missing daughter, but it also branched off into a different plot with altered characters. It features a psychological profiling which alters various in-game elements depending on the player's response to questions in therapy. It lacks the combat that Silent Hill had, and it also replaces the other world with a series of chases and sequences through an alternate, frozen version of the town, but I will go into that game more later on. Overall, the original Silent Hill game received generally positive reviews. It gained an 86 out of 100 and 85% on the website's Metacritic and Game Rankings. The game had sold over 2 million copies, which gained Silent Hill a place in the American PlayStation Greatest Hits budget release. Silent Hill has been compared to Resident Evil a lot, and one editor at GamePro even labeled the game a slick Resident Evil clone. Others believed that it was Konami's answer to Resident Evil. I personally feel like people compared it to Resident Evil because it was what was relevant at the time. Hell, Resident Evil was released in 1996, Resident Evil 2 was released in 1998, and 3 was just released a year later in 1999. So at that point, Resident Evil was very much in people's minds at the time. I believe both series do a much different thing and accomplish it differently. Silent Hill was more of a psychological fear, and it played on that, with disturbing things and the unknown darkness. Resident Evil was a much more action-oriented experience. Also, Silent Hill added another layer of atmosphere and creepiness with the audio it had. The audio was greatly praised in Silent Hill. The voice acting, not so much. It was still remarked a lot better than the Resident Evil voice acting. It was also noted by reviewers that Silent Hill had real-time 3D environments instead of the pre-rendered ones that were in Resident Evil. Both games were still good at what they did on their own. Silent Hill had its fogginess and creepiness. Resident Evil had its zombies and action jump scares. And both of them had puzzles. The game's popularity as the first game in the series was recognized farther, way after its release. A lot of publications later on proclaimed it as one of the best PlayStation games out there. It was also credited to moving B-movie horror elements to psychological styles. Overall, the game has a very strong following, and it's definitely worth checking out if you haven't. It's a travesty that a lot of new gamers out there have not experienced it. It really does let you see where psychological horror has bloomed. And I say anyone should at least try to play it once, at least. Overall, guys, the first game was really seriously amazing to me, and I remember it even to this day. Next up, we're going to explore Silent Hill 2, which was also published by Konami for the PlayStation 2, and developed once again by Team Silent. The game was released 2 years after the first game in 2001. The game was also published on the Xbox that same year as an extended edition. It contained a short bonus scenario and other minor stuff. Then later it was ported to PC in 2002. Then it was even re-released again as a remastered HD version on the PS3 and Xbox 360 in 2012, as part of the Silent Hill HD collection. The game was once again set in, you guessed it, Silent Hill. It wasn't really a direct sequel to the first like you would think it would be. Instead, it was kind of its own thing, with you being James Sutherland, who enters the town after receiving a letter from his deceased wife, saying that she was waiting there for him in a special place in Silent Hill. James is joined by Maria, who has a strong resemblance to his wife. He searches for her and uncovers the truth of her death in a messed up town of Silent Hill. It seems like Silent Hill really brings out the messed up side of everyone, doesn't it? The additional material on the re-releases and the ports included Born from a Wish, which was a small scenario that focused on Maria before she met James. Silent Hill 2 uses a third-person camera once again, and the gameplay this time places a greater emphasis on finding items and solving riddles more than the combat. To me, it definitely has a much greater array of psychological horror at play here. The game is definitely very detailed, with some of the monsters for this game actually being designed as a reflection to James's subconscious, and there are many references to the real world here, including history, films, and literacy works throughout the whole entire game. This game received critical acclaim upon its release. Within the first month of its release, it had sold 1 million copies within all the regions of the game. English language critics praised the atmosphere, graphics, and story, and the monster design, but also criticized the controls for being a little tough to use, but still better than its predecessor. Since the game's release, the game appeared on several critics' top lists for its story and use of metaphors, psychological horror, and taboo topics, as well as the soundtrack and sound design. The game did everything the first game did and nailed it even better. Just like the first game, this one has absolutely no indication on the screen, absolutely no HUD. Again, if you want to see more information such as health, location, and items, you have to go into the menu and check it out. It plays very much like the first game with collecting and reading maps in the same way as before. He also writes down what doors are locked, clues, and obstructions that the game may throw at you along the way on the map. And ultimately, it better farther helps you on what direction to go and just what you have to do. For the players that played the first one, they will feel right at home in this one. It pretty much has all the same mechanics as the first game. Just everything was really improved upon. They definitely hit their stride in this title. The game consists of a lot of running around and getting keys. Basically, go here, solve some puzzle, grab a key, and go to this locked door and continue the story. The riddles are a paramount part of the game, and left for the player to interpret upon theirself. The difficulty levels of some of the enemies in the game and the puzzles are determined by the player before even starting the game. So monsters and puzzles can be easier depending on what you pick. Of course, you also have your radio, which helps you along the way again by detecting monsters and playing that static sound that you love to hear so much when monsters are near. And you'll definitely need it, trust me. There is a thick fog pretty much everywhere, just like the first game. It's also worth noting as a detail that his head tilts whenever he's near an enemy or whenever there's an item nearby. So it definitely gives you some direction if there's something nearby that you really need to figure out. Combat is less of a focus in this game and definitely isn't the star of the show here, but combat never really was the star of the show in any of these games. You'll find 3 melee weapons and 3 guns over the course of the game, and another 2 melee weapons unlocked when you replay the game. I won't spoil the story this time, but it's definitely a very story-driven sort of thing, and it's quite a disturbing tale that weaves in and out. And all I can say is pyramid monster rape. Oh god, I still can't erase that from my mind. Silent Hill 2 features 6 endings, which all presented are equally possible. Konami hasn't really stated which ending is canon though, so no one really knows which ending is true. 2 of the endings, however, are very weird and joke endings. Just plain weird. Which they've always had at least one odd joke ending at least. The development of the game pretty much started right as they finished the first game in 1999. Takeyoshi Sato was the CGI director of this game and conceived the story of it all. The main writing was done by Hiroyuki Owaku and Sato, the latter of which provided most of the dialogue for the female characters. Silent Hill 2 had a much bigger budget than the first game, coming in at $7 to $10 million. The decision to do a sequel was based financially. The first game pretty much was a hit, and it was only the right thing to do. I mean, come on, it was a no-brainer. The first one did so well that it was obvious there was going to be a second game. The team was given a small window to decide what platform they wanted to build on, but since the Xbox and GameCube were pretty much unannounced at the time, they decided to work on the PlayStation 2. Later on, they decided to port it over to the Xbox. The game debuted with the PlayStation 2 version and the Xbox version on March 2001 at the Tokyo Game Show to a purely positive reaction. The game shared the same atmosphere as the first game with its psychological horror tone. The team had a much better understanding of what it wanted to do with this game. They had a lot more of the sense of the environment and they focused on the game's plot. The PlayStation 2's hardware let the team make better work of the fog and shadow special effects. It made the game much more better and creepier. You could see a monster approach within its shadows on the wall from your flashlight, and you knew something was coming for you and it was so unnerving and scary. The team had a difficult time with the camera angles as they didn't really want to affect the gameplay side of things, but they also had a vision of what they wanted to do, so they kinda had to strike a fine balance and blend it all together. The game had a psychological aspect that was much better than the first game, and really messed with the player. Like for one, Mary's letters that you have in your inventory slowly disappear, and you won't even notice until they're gone. So it just kinda messes with you and you wonder what the hell is going on. They looked back at other successful games like Tomb Raider for its 3D environments, and Alone in the Dark for its survival horror elements. The team really wanted to nail this game down and get it absolutely perfect, and they spent a lot of time studying and researching. When working on the characters, Sato and his team sketched out human faces with different emotions. To gain a better sense of the character facial structures, they drew from all sorts of angles. They did a lot of sketching to make the characters before even modeling them in the game. Each character consisted of 6,000 polygons. Which isn't much by today's standards, but back then it was really something. The story is very mature and dark for a video game, touching base on a lot of mature themes and taboos, such as, and are you ready for this? Are you sure? It touches base on a lot of messed up things, such as morality, grief, physical and sexual abuse, suicide, mental illness and health, death and trauma, rape, guilt, existentialism, bullying, domestic violence, incest, loneliness, body image, murder, substance abuse, pain and suffering, loss of loved ones, relationship issues, euthanasia, self-loathing, sexuality, and a lot more. Yeah, a lot of messed up things. This game was seriously freaking messed up. Akira Yamaoka composed the music for Silent Hill 2 at his home. He took 3 days to write the music for the theme of Laura, which was the main theme of the game. It combined a sad melody with a strong beat. Although he doesn't consider a melody to be the most important thing in a music piece, he wanted to evoke some sort of emotion out of the player. The game also has some crazy messed up sound effects. Boy does it ever. The game has 50 sound effects that just mess with you, like footsteps or broken glass. And it just messes with your head, and that's all it's there for. I can still specifically remember being in the hospital, and pretty much being in complete darkness with only a flashlight, and being behind the main counter, and then suddenly hearing a glass shatter in the other room. It made me feel like there was something out there living, waiting, for any chance to get a hold of me out there in the darkness. It really set an unprecedented level of sound design that was truly very psychological and incredibly unsettling. There was also some moments of silence where it was just intentional just to build up, and it just made you wonder what was out there, what was just about to happen, because usually there's silence right before something big. The Xbox port was called Silent Hill 2 Restless Dreams in the US and Inner Fears in Europe. This edition contained a short bonus called Born from a Wish, with a few other minor enhancements. It was later ported back to PS2 with no new subtitle or anything. It was just kind of silently released under the Greatest Hits edition. Lastly, it was ported to PC by Creature Labs. It added the ability to quick save and also the ability to watch trailers for Silent Hill 3. The game was also later released within the HD collection, but we will talk about that monstrosity later on. Silent Hill 2 was positively received and sold over 1 million copies in its first month between all regions. It had an 85% on game rankings and an 89 out of 100 on Metacritic. It's worth noting that the PC received a lower score. The game was praised for being frightening and yet restraining. There was a ton of positive things to say about the game. Some said it was exactly what was needed for survival horror. Some said it was deep and very clever. Most said it was a frightening experience. It was also praised for the graphics and atmosphere that it had. One highlighted the smooth transition from CG to the in-game cutscenes, and the sense of claustrophobia caused by the fog. It was also said that the fog and grainy filter hurt the environments, that it kind of covered it up a little bit too much. Also, it was said that the exterior environments rarely pushed the PS2. Though the character details and animation was considered realistic by many reviewers. Some said that the monster designs were less frightening due to the abundance of ammo, and also the monsters could be easily avoided. Some also found the camera angles, though to be better than the first game, still difficult to be in and see while you're fighting the monstrosities in the game. The sound was highly praised, understandably, as it's one of the best aspects of the game, in my opinion. The puzzles were generally seen as not overly challenging by the reviewers. Most found to just be easy sometimes felt forced and contrived. It was also said that the puzzles were illogical. Even less well received was the combat for its lack of challenge in easily defeating the monsters and bosses. I never really liked the combat in the Silent Hill games. It's always just kind of felt clunky and awkward to me. Silent Hill 2 today is considered to be one of the greatest horror games of all time. Now that may be just an opinion, but it's probably a really strong opinion. And it's probably due to the story it has and the use of metaphors and psychological horror and taboo topics. It really doesn't hold anything back. It ranked number 1 on XPlay's list of scariest games of all time in 2006. IGN listed it as one of the top 5 best horror games created after 2000 in 2009. Overall, the game definitely has its strong points, and a very strong following. And it's many gamers' favorite go-to scary game. I recommend playing this if you haven't done so already. It will definitely mess with your head. Next in the demented line of games is Silent Hill 3. This game is still published and made by the same team, Konami, Team Silent, we all know. This is the third installment in the series. But this one is also a direct sequel to the first Silent Hill game. The game was released in 2003 on the PlayStation 2, and was ported over to the PC the same year. It's also worth mentioning that it was in the HD collection on the PS3 and Xbox 360, which again we will get to later. The gameplay is focused much on the same as the last two games, with the three elements being combat, exploration, and puzzles, with a third-person camera angle once again. The main character, Heather, can also block and perform a sidestep dodge to avoid monsters. Once again, the flashlight and radio are a paramount part of the game, and you'll need them both along the way, much in the same way you needed them in the last games. The flashlight is often your only defense in the darkness, and your radio alerts you with the sound to tell that monsters are near. Players once again set the difficulty of their choice, and it will make puzzles either harder or easier depending on what you choose. I must say the difference between medium and hard is very vast. For medium, you only have to know a simple pattern recognition, but on hard, with the same puzzle, you will be required to know a lot of knowledge about Shakespeare. Doesn't make a ton of sense to me. The game is once again set in Silent Hill, and it is 17 years after the first game. You are Heather, the teenage adopted daughter of Harry Mason from the first game. Heather is trying to figure out why the cult of Silent Hill is pursuing her. She meets a lot of interesting people along the way, with an interesting tale being told. Heather awakens in the beginning of the game at a coffee shop. She must have fell asleep and she started dreaming. She was trapped in this weird, strange amusement park, and she was forced onto roller coaster tracks, being chased by monsters. Then, she was inevitably hit by a roller coaster, and that's where she wakes up from her dream. She is looking for information about her birth, and a private detective calls her with information, but for some reason, she says, screw that. And that is when she finds herself in an abandoned hellish mall, full of nothing but monsters. Now, I won't really spoil any of the story, because I think you should play on your own. But it's a very interesting story that results in most of the same, a player being messed up in Silent Hill. This one has only three endings though, one normal one, one messed up one, and one joke one. The development of the PS2 version began after the release of the second installment. They certainly wasted no time. This game was actually being developed alongside another Silent Hill title that was intended to explore a much different approach to the Silent Hill games, and it wasn't a part of the main series. I guess they really wanted to turn out Silent Hill games pretty fast, which I could understand, it was a pretty hot commodity at the time. The other project was known as Room 302, and we will get to that one in a bit. First, let's talk about three more. The development team for Silent Hill 3 was actually smaller than the one that worked on 2. Essentially, it was the core team that worked on 2 plus a few new people. A smaller group also ported it to Windows. Like all the previous games, one of the game's influences was Jacob's Ladder. One of the subway platforms is named Bergen Street Station, the same station that Jacob was inquiring about in the beginning of the film. Just an interesting little tidbit. Here's another. The developers also cited horror writer Stephen King as another one of their influences. Silent Hill 3 also incorporates references drawn from real-life actors and actresses. This was a time where they couldn't just motion capture people's faces within the game. There just wasn't as much technology back then as there is now. So anyway, the private detective known as Douglas Cartland in the game got his name from the American actor Douglas Fairbanks. The team said there was no real connection to the actor other than the name, it just suited the character. During sketching, his character model was modeled after Giancarlo Giannini, I think I'm saying that right, I'm not really sure, and Ian Holm. So the game's characters definitely had its fair share of inspiration. The soundtrack was once again done by Akira Yamaoka, and it was released in Europe in March 2003, and in Japan in July of 2003. Apparently there was no love for the US there. It was the first soundtrack made by him that prominently used vocals. The game was very well received and had lots of positive reviews, much like the last game. It pretty much had the same scores, again with the PC port being lower. The PC ports didn't fare that well due to the fact that the PC was a much bigger platform, and the reviewers pretty much compared it to other combat-based games, and Silent Hill just wasn't up to par with that. Also, a few people noted that the controller support was very, very spotty. Can you take a wild guess at what people liked about the game? That's right, the horror factor, of course. The positive reactions were given to the general horror and atmosphere of the game, including people saying that there was truly horrifying sections, and that it packed some genuine scares, and that the feeling of eeriness and doom was always overwhelming. The story told as part of the atmosphere was also well received. Also, the graphics, audio, and production values were also greatly received as well, and they were all positive for the reviews. Most of the criticism came from the game not really being innovative in any way. The gameplay was pretty much the same. It didn't really do anything different or new, and basically, if you played the other Silent Hills, you played this one. You already know what you're getting into. I guess they decided to follow the, if it isn't broken, don't fix it method of thinking. But the series could have used some fine-tune in combat at least. I would have greatly appreciated that. The other problem was always one that the series had. The camera and control system was not that good. The sometimes fixed camera angles just made combat a little bit more frustrating and hard to deal with, along with the dated controls on top of that. Other criticisms were that the game was quite short. There were many people saying that the game could easily be beaten in a few hours. The game sold over 300,000 copies by November of 2003, and the game also topped sales charts in Japan upon its release. It's also worth noting that there was a film adaptation of Silent Hill 3 called Silent Hill Revelation 3D, which was released October of 2012 by Open Road Films. The film is a sequel to the film adaptation of the first installment of the series. It had a cast straight from the game. However, the movie did really poorly and was not that well received. It got a 5% approval rating from Rotten Tomatoes, and the general consensus was that it was just mediocre at best, even by the standards of video game adaptations, which, ouch, that's saying a lot. Many said it had weak characters and an incomprehensible plot, with a shortage of scares. The game did a lot better, however. Even if it didn't really do anything innovative, if you love the series, you're still gonna love 3. And many other people felt the same way. So do you remember me saying that there was another game in development at the same time as 3? Room 302? Of course, once again, it was done by the same people. The game was released in 2004 for the PlayStation 2, Xbox, and the PC, and it got the new name Silent Hill 4, The Room. Its soundtrack was released at the same time. The game was also re-released in 2012 on the Japanese PlayStation Network. Unlike the previous games, this one wasn't even set in the town of Silent Hill. Instead, the game is set in a fictional town known as South Ashfield, and follows Henry Townshend as he tries to escape his locked apartment. During the course of the game, Henry explores a series of supernatural worlds, and finds himself in conflict with an undead serial killer. Silent Hill 4 features an altered gameplay style with a third-person navigation and plot elements taken from the previous games, and the departure from Silent Hill had a range of different reactions. The gameplay centers around this apartment, which you also have to navigate through in first-person view, which is quite different. The apartment also holds the one and only save point in the game. The other areas of the game are also reached through holes that form in the apartment, which is a little strange, but seems quite normal for a Silent Hill game. For the first half of the game, the room restores Henry's health, but the second half of the game, the room becomes haunted and messed up and it drains Henry's health. In the main levels of the game, the player uses the typical third-person camera. The game throws a limited inventory menu at you, so you have to use it wisely and pick and choose what you want, and leave the items that you feel are unnecessary to you in the chest in Henry's room. Silent Hill emphasizes combat during the gameplay, with a near absence of complex puzzles, in favor of more simple item-seeking tasks. Also, another thing that sets it apart from the other previous installments, there is no separate setting of difficulty for puzzles and combat. It's all one thing now. I guess that's fair since there's not really a big emphasis on puzzles in this game. In the second half of the game, Harry has his neighbor Eileen Galvin, who helps him and tags along. She cannot die while with Henry, but she can take damage, and if she takes too much damage, she can become possessed. Also, depending on how much damage Eileen takes during the game, she may not live during the ending, so it definitely does affect the game. The combat is mostly the same from the last games with a few changes to it. The player has access to a variety of melee weapons, but there is only two options for guns in the game. Also, certain melee weapons can only endure so much before they break after a certain point. Other items such as talismans, which provide protection against hauntings in Henry's room, also have a level of endurance and they break after a short period of time. Another key difference is the melee attacks that you can now charge up and do a lot more damage to the monsters. One of the more significant changes to the game is the introduction of immortal ghosts, known as the victims of the antagonist. The ghosts have the ability to hurt Henry, but damage can be reflected if you have the right items. Ghosts can be knocked down for an extended period of time with one or two of your special bullets, or you can pin them to the ground permanently if you have a special sword. Henry is the average everyday man described as an introvert in his late 20s. He just wants to figure out what the hell is going on in his apartment and wants to know why he can't get out, and also why the hell there are so many portals in his room. At the beginning of the game, Henry was locked in his apartment for 5 days with no means of communication to the outside world, and he was also having nightmares. Shortly after that point, he discovers a human-sized hole in his bathroom. What would any rational person do? Well, I know I would nope the hell out, but Henry doesn't. He climbs into the hole and sees where it leads. Like, who the hell does that? I guess after 5 days of no communication with the outside world and being trapped in your apartment, I guess I would also go through a random hell portal in my bathroom. Now after that point, he starts to meet people, and once again, Silent Hill comes into play. They eventually find a way to get Henry's apartment from hell to become unpossessed and haunted after a lot of things go down. There are 4 possible endings in the game that are determined whether Eileen dies or not, and also the condition of Henry's apartment by the end of the game. 3 of the endings are pretty normal endings for the game, but the 4th one, yep, it's another joke one, which has become a staple for the series. Like I said, this game was in development at the same time 3 was, with the intention of creating a whole new style of game that would take the series in a whole different direction. Despite what was being popularized by the internet, this game was always intended to be a Silent Hill game, just not part of the main series. For some reason, people believed that it was supposed to be a completely different game unrelated to Silent Hill. That's just not the case. I think people believe that because it was radically different than the past games. The changes in the formula to the game were completely intentional and warranted because 3 was so similar to the rest of the games, and 3 ended up getting a lot of complaints for that. The main concept behind the game was structured around the idea of this room. Your room is probably supposed to be the safest place to you, right? It's your haven away from the hell of the world. So what if it was made to be a danger zone, and you had no level of comfort? The first-person perspective that was included in the game to travel around your apartment makes it more personal and claustrophobic. It leaves the player with the intentional feeling of a slight unease. The other environments, however, retain the third-person view that we're all used to. It was noted that the game, much like the previous games, also drew inspiration from the movie Jacob's Ladder, and Henry Townsend shares a likeness to the actor Peter Krause. The apartment and the concept of the hole is also comparable to a similar space in a novel known as The House of Leaves by Mark Danielewski. Other nods included the novel Rosemary's Baby, Twin Peaks, and once again Stephen King. The soundtrack was once again composed by Yamaoka, and had vocals by Mary Elizabeth McGlynn and Joe Ramoza. The Japanese version featured a second disc containing music played alongside reading of a traditional Japanese story. The American version, however, contained 13 exclusive tracks and remixes. I'm actually surprised there was an American version this time. Upon the game's release, it attracted mainstream news outlets like CNN, the BBC, and The Times. Silent Hill topped the game sales in Japan during a video game sales slump, but dropped to 10th place a week later. Official statements by Konami referred to the sale of the game in North America as favorable. It, however, got a lower score of 76 out of 100 on Metacritic. CNN said that the game, unlike horror movies, which movies often got worse after each new sequel. It was also said that the series gets better and creepier with age. Game Informer also praised the game, stating that its disarming voyeurism, bizarre camera angles, and exceptionally well tension is what the series has always been trying to do, but this is the first time it actually accomplishes it. CBS Interactive had said that the game was just a clunky PS1 throwback, with all the design wit of a dodo. They must have been playing a completely different game and got confused. The New York Times said that the game was completely lacking in terror. IGN also stated that the game's story was too familiar compared to the past storylines of the games, and that it detracted from the horror appeal, although they cared about the characters a lot more than they did in previous games. I guess everyone had their different opinion and perspective on the game. Much like any series, some will love it, some will hate it. A majority of the praise, though, was because of the plot of the game, and it was well received, and was said to be horrifying, compelling, and dark. 1UP.com said that it constantly maintained a sense of unease for the player. Game Revolution had said that they enjoyed the relative normal appearance of the environments outside of Henry's room in the beginning of the game. A majority liked the voice acting, although it did receive some criticism for the calmness of the main character. I mean, I would be freaking out in that case, so I don't know how he is so calm. Even the producer and composer Yamaoka had said that the characters to him were pretty weak. The graphics and the environments in the game were praised as detailed. GameStop had said that the game looks best in its corroded, bloody, gritty environments, like the damp steel halls of the water prison, or the subterranean subway layers, which at one point had walls that were living and moving in flesh. Seems pretty Silent Hill to me. The monster and character designs also got a lot of praise for being well done. The audio was also well received, which is no surprise to me because it's always been superb. This game was a breath of fresh air for Silent Hill by making all the changes that it did, and people took notice about it. GameZone said that the changes were needed to make it fresh again. However, it wasn't all great. People thought that it was highly inconvenient to have to return to your room all the time because it was the only save point in the game, and also you had to store items in your room as well. There was no option to discard any items, so anytime you needed space, you had to go back and put the unwanted items in your chest. The game was also very much criticized for its lack of puzzles and the greater emphasis on combat and item collecting. To me, what made the Silent Hill games was the puzzles. It's a staple of the series. To completely abandon the standard of Silent Hill puzzles, it's just not a good thing to me. Combat should never be the highlight of a Silent Hill game. I've never really enjoyed the combat in the games. It's always had an unnatural feel and always felt frustrating to me. It was the one aspect that I never really liked about the games. The game also had the complaint of lack of boss fights, and also reusing the first four environments in the second half of the game made it seem a bit lazy. And the PC version got a 67 out of 100 on Metacritic, and it was said to have very blurry textures and some serious graphical glitches. There was also complaints about the mouse sensitivity being too low, and that it inhibited the gameplay. Overall, the game had its fair share of problems, but it was still more praised than not. I personally didn't enjoy this game too much, as I didn't really like how much it set itself apart from the other Silent Hill games. It was just way too different from my taste. I was expecting a Silent Hill game, and it really did not deliver that to me. But I may give it another try at some point. Silent Hill Origins was the next game in line, which was also known as Silent Hill Zero in Japan. It was developed on the PSP and later ported to PS2. This was the first game that wasn't made by Team Silent, but it was still published by Konami. As you would probably gather from the title, it was a prequel to the first Silent Hill game. It's the tale of a trucker named Travis Grady, who is searching for information on a girl that he rescued from a burning house. Along the way, he starts to unlock repressed childhood memories. He has a very troubled past, and he suffers from nightmares. There are also a lot of characters that return from the first game. It starts out with Travis driving his truck and avoid hitting a spirit that was in the middle of the road. While he follows the spirit that caused the crash, he comes upon a burning building, and he saves a girl. He then loses consciousness and wakes up in the town, but he doesn't know if the girl survived or not. There are three endings available in the game. One good ending, one bad ending, and then of course the joke ending, because it just wanted to be a Silent Hill game without one. The gameplay is pretty similar to the other Silent Hill games, more referring to the first three instead of four. Four was kind of its own thing. Needless to say, I probably don't have to tell you that the game revolved around combat, exploration, and puzzles. Yay! Puzzles was back. I bet a lot of people were happy about that. You've got your handy dandy flashlight and static radio, because it wouldn't really be a Silent Hill game without either one of those things. The game also had a cause and effect mechanic in the game. You have the Silent Hill world, and then you have the other world, which of course we all know is a scary place where you just want to ball up in a corner and cry. If you do something in one world, it will affect the other world. Each world has its own reaction. Like raising one prop in one world may open up a path in another. Solving riddles like this lead to a boss battle, which once you defeat the boss, it will bring you to a new area of the game to explore. Combat is pretty similar to the other games where you have melee and firearms. They carried over the feature of having weapons break over time from 4. This is, however, the very first game where you can actually use your fists and go around punching monsters. I don't really advise doing that, but it's there. You also have unbreakable weapons that do a one-shot kill. Of course, Travis is vulnerable when he does this, so quick enemies will make quick work of him. Origins also introduced a grapple system. Around this time in video games, developers started putting in these QuickTime events, and it started to get popular, and of course it was thrown in with the use of grappling. Anytime you grappled a monster, there would be a QuickTime mechanic. Once again, just like most Silent Hill games, there was no heads-up display. You either have to go into the menu to see his health, or the screen will indicate when he's in critical condition by the edges of the screen turning red, and you will hear his heartbeat. The first preview of the game was actually a departure from the series. Instead of the typical Silent Hill third-person camera angle, you had more of a Resident Evil 4 camera angle behind the shoulder, and it had more of an emphasis on action and combat to a greater degree. In the preview, the character had 3 melee weapons and 3 guns, and there was also an option for players to barricade areas. At the time, the game was expected to release in 2006. Issues of the game's engine and confused high-level vision for the game led to the game's production to be transferred to another studio. They wanted to ensure that the product was more focused and had an approach towards fans. I mean, people wanted a Silent Hill game, not a Resident 4 clone. The script, level design, and monsters were all redone in 1 week by Sam Barlow. The developers intentionally replicated aspects of the first game so the gameplay was more in line with the previous games instead of the monstrosity that the other team tried to do. Later previews showed that the game was more similar to the other games, and it was completely different than the other previews that I talked about. The new previews looked a lot more like Silent Hill, and the changes were very well received by journalists. On August 2007, a demo was leaked on the internet. Climax denied that they were the source of the leak. In November 2007, the game was finally released on the PSP, and it was the first time that the series had went portable. I don't really count the Game Boy Advance game, because it was more of a visual novel than an actual game, and it was never released out of Japan anyway. Later, the PlayStation 2 got the port in March of 2008, and then it became available on the PlayStation Network in 2014. Once again, Yamaoka did the music for the game. It was decided to make the music fall more in line with the first game since it was a prequel. Once again, just like the other games, it was very well received with a 78 out of 100 on Metacritic. Game Daily wrote that it impressively brings all the elements loved from the series to a portable format, and it worked really wonderfully. 1UP.com said, "Sure, it was predictable, conventional, and a little short, not to mention ill-suited for pickup and play on the bus, but we're encouraged to see developers making an original, console-quality experience on the PSP." The storyline, however, was met with mixed feelings from reviewers. According to GameStop, the premise was unoriginal and unsuspenseful, detracting from Travis's appeal as a protagonist, although they did feel that the game provided new material for the fans to analyze. The general consensus was that it felt like the game had taken the console's game and shrunk it down and placed it into a handheld. Some reviewers noted though that the character models could have been more detailed. The gameplay drew a variety of reactions that ranged from immersive and intriguing to formulaic. The puzzles were generally considered challenging and well done. However, it was a very short game and was also criticized for the spacing of the save points and absence of checkpoints. I mean, if you're going to have a portable game, save points and checkpoints are certainly a must. Because if you play it on the go like you usually would anything else, you may have to suddenly stop, and you might find yourself losing some progress. This was a drawback, but I think if you're going to immerse yourself in the world of Silent Hill, you're probably not going to do it on a bus or in a doctor's office. The combat once again wasn't really stellar, and a lot of people really didn't like it. Some people felt that the player was encouraged to actually avoid combat, due to the variety of gameplay factors that included breakable melee weapons. I mean, I tried to avoid combat in almost all the Silent Hill games, it just wasn't my thing. There was also a lot of people that just really didn't like the inclusion of QuickTime grappling either. It didn't really add anything, and it felt like they just added it because they were jumping on the QuickTime event bandwagon. The game still did really well though. Even though it was a portable game, the game still got a few good scares out of people, and still managed to keep its creepy vibe. And the soundtrack for the game was amazing like always. It added that creepy layer of atmosphere that Silent Hill was known for. If you play this on PSP, earphones are a must. The PS2 port didn't fare that well though. It got a 70 out of 100. The graphics were considered very poor for the PS2, and just overall was not that great. The graphics were built for the PSP in mind, and because of that, it was a lot better than the PS2 counterpart. Other complaints were that the port did not have manual camera controlling, and there was no mini-map or overall map at all, which just gave the game an unnecessary challenge in some areas. Overall, there isn't many options for Silent Hill on the go, and this one did pretty well. It nailed the atmosphere and the scary side of things. It's pretty much on the same level as the console games, just portable. I feel like it was a very good thing that this game was handed off to a more competent team, who made it feel like Silent Hill instead of some Resident Evil clone. Just because something is popular doesn't mean you should replicate it and sacrifice the source material. You're not only screwing over a long-time series, but you're also screwing over the fanbase that the games already had. So I'm really glad it worked out the way it did. The sixth installment of the series was a return to consoles. The first new Silent Hill game officially released for the PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360. It was released in September of 2008, and also had a PC release alongside the console versions. This was the first Silent Hill console game that was not done by Team Silent. Instead, it was done by Double Helix Games. You are Alex Shepard, a special forces soldier who returns home from an overseas tour to find your father and younger brother missing, and also that your mother is, well, not all there. So Alex begins to search for his brother, leading him to, you guessed it, Silent Hill. The gameplay has a similar tone to the last games, such as exploring messed up Silent Hill-esque environments and searching for clues to advance the story. You have to find pictures and drawings and other items, which are then placed in Alex's journal. Again, this game has a head assist mechanic, which was found in 2, in which Alex turns his head towards different items that are nearby. But now weapons and ammo also give off a glow to the player to help them better see them in the darkness. Puzzle elements also play out in this game, in which you have to decipher puzzles like keypads and similar things. One thing that is different about this game than the other games is the dialogue. The player can select different responses when engaging in conversations with the other characters in the game. This will ultimately affect how the player sees the plot unfold in the game. Combat is another major change in this one. I must say the combat is a lot more fluid, and they really much took care of all the problems that I had with it. The game takes into account that Alex is a special forces soldier, and is well trained and versed in combat. The other installments in the series just kind of have this average guy protagonist, but this one, you have someone who's an expert in combat, so it only makes sense to beef up the combat engine. The player is now able to do light and heavy attacks, and you can also mix it up to pull off combinations. You can now also do finishing moves to make sure monsters are extra dead. After all, you don't want them coming back and getting you. Attacking enemies also leave visible wounds that match the motion carried out by Alex. The controls to me is a step forward in this game. You can now do new things like targeting the enemy before you attack them, so it definitely has less of an awkward combat feeling to it. You can also dodge attacks and then counter them as well. And you have lots and lots of different melee weapons alongside pistols, rifles, and shotguns, which they can also be upgraded, and they will become a lot stronger later on in the game. You can now fully control and rotate the camera as much as you want, which fixes a lot of the awkward camera angles that the older games had. But to me, the awkward camera angles added a little bit to the Silent Hill-esque nature of the game. It gave the older games a little bit of an unsettling feeling, but I can't complain because they fixed a major complaint that people had. Chief designer of the game, Masashi Tsuboyama, I hope I'm saying that right, announced the game in 2004 in an interview with Eurogamer. He also was able to disperse the rumors that the game was going to be called Shadows of the Past. There was no more information about the release at all, other than it was going to appear on next-gen consoles at the time, which was the PlayStation 3 and the Xbox 360. Around 2 years later, Akira Yamaoka revealed more information. He said that they had hopes of carrying on a similar plan to the earlier games, and that the team was creating a title with the idea of Fear in Daylight, with the similar psychological roots of Silent Hill 2. It was suggested that the gameplay was going to be a lot more like Silent Hill 2 in the way that the player was directed throughout the game. and it was later reaffirmed on an interview along with the idea of creating it for the PS3 and 360. At E3 2007, a new trailer was shown. It was displayed by Konami and revealed the title Silent Hill 5, and of course it was to be released on the PS3 and 360. Farther into the trailer, it revealed that the developer was not Team Silent this time around, but instead it was Double Helix Games. The team not only drew inspiration from the past games in the series, but also from the first Silent Hill movie, the one that actually got good reviews. This was evident with how Silent Hill transitioned into the hellish other world, which was incredibly cool looking with its ripping effect, as it sent you into the other world. Other similarities between the movie and the game was the nurses and how they reacted to light, and also the bug creatures which were present in the movie. Lastly, the pyramid head in this game is also known as the Bogeyman. Lead designer Jason Allen described that there was going to be the intention of maintaining the depth and storytelling and atmosphere while making combat a lot less frustrating and more intuitive. Despite the change of the development team, Akira Yamaoka returned to do the music and sound effects for the game. Yamaoka wrote 70 minutes for the game, and it was also a first for the series to have surround sound. This game had trouble getting past the censors in some countries before it could go on sale. The Australia board refused to classify the game due to impact violence and excessive blood effects. The scenes in question were scenes where various body parts were being drilled into, and also a scene where there was a bisection of a character by an enemy. This had the effect of banning the game for sale in that country. Is it just me or does Australia love to censor games? Anyway, Konami toned down the game for the country and permitted to sell it in 2009. The German version of the game also was postponed until 2009, for cuts being made to pass the German censors after the uncensored version was rejected. They ended up having to do the same exact censors that they did for the Australian game to the German copy. Homecoming was finally coming out in September 2008, with a 70 out of 100 on Metacritic. There was also a PC version that was only available on Steam. I don't know if it's actually only available on Steam now though. Many people felt that the change in developers was a positive thing overall. Double Helix was under a ton of scrutiny from developers and fans alike. There was some faults in the game, but they still ultimately felt like it was a better change. I mean, come on. It was the first time combat did not feel so clunky and completely a mess. It was highly praised for the graphics and cinematic approach that it took. Everything seemed like an upgrade from the past titles in the series. Everyone seemed to love the creepy transition to the other world, which they did very, very well. It was definitely cool in a disturbing, I might die here sort of way. One thing that was a surprise to a whole bunch of people was the flashlight. In the older games, the flashlight was the focal point within the darkness. It was the only thing that stood in the way between monsters and the player. But in this game, it was a lot less effective. A lot of the game was played in the dark, but the flashlight was just very weak. It made stuff like doors hard to spot. Now I know why they made their items glow, because otherwise you wouldn't be able to find them. Once again, Yamaoka had hit the soundtrack right out of the park. It was hailed very atmospheric, moody, and beautifully presented. The audio went a long way establishing the Silent Hill mood. There were some concerns, however, that the music was somewhat misplaced and it didn't fit too well. However, the voice acting was praised for being better than usual, but occasionally falling flat with the emotion that it needed. The game's plot was received with a large mixed reception. Some said it was intriguing and disturbing. It was also noted that it wasn't particularly original, and there was no real surprises. Zero Punctuation had said that the level design, story, and combat was all competent, but the game had little to do with what they liked about Silent Hill. I agree that this game misses a lot of the marks. It was more of a story sidestep for the Silent Hill series. It never really mentioned any of the previous characters from the other games, and it sort of just felt like its own story and thing. I did like it because the combat was very much improved, but I felt myself wishing that it was more Silent Hill-esque. If they took the combat in this game and actually made a Silent Hill 2, they can just take my money and sign me up for the pre-order. Overall, the game does do Silent Hill some justice as it is creepy and disturbing like other games, but it could have added more mythos and background from the other games. I mean, all the other games built the foundation and lore for Silent Hill. They could have used it at least a little bit. Next in the long disturbing conga line of games is Silent Hill Downpour. It was developed by another new team, Vatcher Games, and once again it was being published by Konami. In 2010, Konami screamed its first trailer for Downpour at a conference in San Francisco. and also released that the game was being worked on by Vatra Games. It was given the working title Silent Hill 8 at E3 2010. The online profile for Vatra Studio had led speculation that Downpour may be a first-person shooter, which would have been a dramatic shift for the series, and I can't say it would have been a good one. That would have been way too separated from what the series was about. Too much disconnect would have killed the series in my opinion. The soundtrack belongs to the industrial music genre, but to a lesser extent than the previous games. It emphasized sounds produced by use of objects made by organic matter as musical instruments. For the first time, Yamaoka wasn't involved in the production of the soundtrack or the sounds in the game, which to me is a little bit sad. Instead, it was taken over by Daniel Licht. He produced the sounds and the soundtrack for the game this time around. There was, however, a lot of controversy over the fact that Downpour's main theme was performed by a band called Korn, who was more of a heavy metal band. A lot of people really didn't like it. Fans even started a petition to get the song removed from the soundtrack. The song wasn't really that bad and I don't see the big deal, but that's just me. I can understand how fans can get protective over a series, and how things can happen like that, but I feel it was unwarranted. The game takes place in and near Silent Hill. You are an inmate, Murphy Pendleton. You have the third-person view, and you have to go through the monster-filled town of Silent Hill. Your transport bus crashes. Why does it seem like the town loves to make people crash off the side of the road? He wakes up and finds himself in the town, mostly abandoned, except for a few characters here and there. There were 6 endings in the game, which was the most the series has had in a while. The endings were varied by the choices that you made in the game. There is, of course, one joke ending among them for good measure. The gameplay focused on exploration, puzzles, and combat. Sound familiar? There was even some side quests that involved the inhabitants of the town. The player can shape the character throughout the game, with several moral choices to make along the way, and ultimately that will choose which ending you get. For combat, he can only carry one melee weapon at a time, which will gradually deteriorate and break over time. Guns and ammo are actually pretty scarce, and Murphy has difficulty aiming the gun. I like how the game's tailored to the protagonist. It made it a little bit more realistic. His health was reflected in his appearance, which I think is a pretty cool little detail. The more damage you took and the worse your health got, the more his clothes would become bloodied and torn. The game also featured a real-time weather system, which was another first for the series. Rainfall will come down periodically, and when it rains, monsters will appear a lot more frequent and a lot stronger. Who knew that the rain in Silent Hill had steroids in it? The game released on the PlayStation 3 and 360 in March of 2012, and it had a mixed reception. It received a 68 out of 100 on Metacritic, which was the lowest score out of all the games. Generally, critics were split by the game's story and the atmosphere, yet they criticized the combat and technical performance. This is also the first game in the series that did not get a PC release since the first one. Game Informer gave it a 7 out of 10, stating that they didn't regret their time with the game, but mediocrity hung over the game's playthrough. Destructoid gave it an 8 out of 10, and said that when the game's not forcing a subpar combat system on the player, and when it actually allows itself to be imaginative, Downpour is stylish, slickly produced, and beautifully foreboding. The most negative review came from IGN, who gave it a 4.5 out of 10. And the review said that the most frustrating thing about the game wasn't the lousy combat, the dull exploration, or even the technical side of things. It's the fact that now and then while playing the game's story, you'll see signs of brilliance, sunlight hinted behind the overcast sky. I do believe the game was an alright game myself. It was lackluster at best, and I do see where everyone was coming from when they said that they've seen bursts of promise in the game. It did have some good moments where it shined and came together, but a majority of it just wasn't that great. Not bad, but not great either. The only thing that seemed to purely be positive about the game was the soundtrack. Although many felt that the loss of not having Yamaoka on board was still a detriment because he was there for the whole series up to this point. I believe the game had a whole bunch of potential, and they should have just kept working on it and developing it. It needed a lot more polish, and it could have really been something awesome, but it fell short in way too many ways and a lot of people felt the same way. Now these games were all the main games in the series up to this point. There are, however, more games, but I don't feel like they are a main part of the series. Their stories are more of a sidestep or retelling of it. So these are the games I'm going to talk about now. Silent Hill Shattered Memories was developed by Climax Studios and published by Konami in December of 2009. It was ported over to the PS2 and PSP later that year. It was also worth noting that the game was released on the PlayStation Network in Europe in 2014. This was a complete reimagining of the very first game in the series. It retains the premise of the original that Harry Mason was on this messed up journey to find his daughter through the town of Silent Hill. The differences being that it is set in a different fictional universe, has a different plot, altered characters, and some new characters as well. The gameplay takes place in two parts. One being a first-person psychotherapy session, and then there's an over-the-shoulder view through Silent Hill, which is periodically interrupted by a shift to an alternate dimension. Answers given to the psychological tests and therapy sessions affect various gameplay elements in Harry's journal. If you are seeing lots of similarities between this and Silent Hill Origins, it's because the game is pretty much a sequel to that very game, and made by the same studio, so this one is in the same vein as that game. After they designed Origins, they intentionally replicated that so they could keep taking a different approach to the series. Among the changes that they made to the game, the big one being the removal of combat altogether, and the constant presence of monsters. So yeah, this was taking one different approach, being that there was no combat or a significant amount of monsters in the game. And at this point, you're probably asking yourself, how did it work? Well, the player would navigate Harry in an over-the-shoulder view and search for his daughter. He has a smartphone and a flashlight with him, which he can use the phone to check his location on the GPS, take photos, and make phone calls. Moving to a certain spot will get you lots of interference, which can translate to a lot of radio noise. You can also take pictures where shadowy figures can be seen. Doing all these things will net you various text messages and voicemails, and that in turn expands the story. In the Wii version, the Wii remote was used to help solve puzzles and also control the flashlight and the cell phone. The game occasionally shifted to this icy alternate dimension called Nightmare, which I guess you could kind of compare to the other world, but not quite. In the Nightmare realm, this is where the hostile monster exists. To escape from this nightmare world, Harry must find the predetermined exit, while avoiding the wandering creatures, which will give him a chase if they find him. Unlike the previous games, there is no combat in this one at all. You also have absolutely no weapons to protect yourself with. You can only run and slow down the monsters by knocking down various objects in the pathway. You can also ward them off by using a flare, which can be found on the ground sometimes. His running speed and health decrease every time a monster catches him, and you had to break free from their hold and get away again. Also, there is only one type of monster compared to all sorts of various other creatures in other games. Just one here, which I find a little odd and maybe a step back. The one kind of monster can change its appearance though, depending on what Harry said in the psychological tests. Early development into the game, the team decided to visit a psychiatrist for research. The use of ice as a visual in the game was partly because the developer wanted to create another world for the game that the first Silent Hill had made prominent, and that was the snowfall theme, and it also seemed very common where the fictional town was located. They really wanted to set this game apart from the rest of the games and create their own horror game feel. I can't say they didn't accomplish that because it's definitely different. They were hoping this game would draw in new fans because it was a fresh new take on the series, but they also hoped the old fans jumped on the bandwagon too because it was the series after all. They avoided the common style that the series has been known for. They didn't want to have a player that was powerful or someone that was good at combat. They were not going to follow the common survival horror techniques. Instead, they generated an unarmed character and examined the survival horror gameplay staple of difficult combat and sluggish opponents. They also analyzed around 50 chase sequences from various horror movies and slasher films. They also drew inspiration from common childhood nightmares about running away from an unknown threat, and they decided to incorporate this into the game as an intelligent enemy who was capable of not only trailing you, but was also indeed faster than you. The chase sequences were designed to not only scare you, but also to build tension. However, they also didn't want to prolong the tension with the constant presence of the monsters, and they were concerned that this would become overwhelming for the player and spoil the immersion. Akira Yamaoka also did the soundtrack for this game, and it was his final contribution to the Silent Hill series before resigning from Konami after 16 years with the company. The game is also the first in the series to have prominent use of dynamic music, in which a composition is introduced and then retracted based on the character's actions. The soundtrack also had a lot more variance from undertones to rock music. A demo was playable at 2009's E3, and it received favorable reviews from journalists. A group of editors at IGN gave the game 3 Best of E3 awards, in the Wii category for Best Overall Game, Best Adventure Game, and the Best Video Game Graphic Technology. They were also given the Best Wii Game award by the editors at GameSpot in an article about their preferred games from E3. According to the producer, Tom Hewlett, the number of pre-orders for the game looked very good. In 2010, it placed 5th on a list of 40 best-selling PS2 games in the UK, and 11th on the corresponding list for the Wii. However, a Nintendo World Report had said that the sales of the game were actually pretty low. The game eventually broke even with the help of the PS2 port, selling an estimated 440,000 copies. It had a 79 out of 100 gaming score on Metacritic, and the game got generally favorable reviews. VideoGamer.com ranked Silent Hill Shattered Memories 7th in their list of top nerve-shredding video games, and wrote, "Dark, dank, and dangerous. Silent Hill grabs you by the scruff of your neck, shakes you until you throw up, then headbutts you right between the eyes." Game of Suture ranked the game 5th place in the top 10 list of overlooked games of 2009, and wrote that despite the absence of horror elements, the game was a nice experience. IGN also included the game in their list of overlooked Wii games, and wrote that the combination of various elements, which they regarded as positive, delivered a meticulously constructed, expertly paced experience, quite unlike anything that the series had seen before. I could go on all day about everything positive that everyone has said about this game. Believe me, there is plenty. At the end of the day, everyone has said that the game was innovative and quite unique to the series, and it was a nice refreshment to the series and what it was. Although there was a whole bunch of positive things to say about the game, it's also had its fair share of things that people did not like about it. About.com wrote, that the fast-paced action of the nightmare sequences and the therapy scenes undercut the trapped-in-a-nightmare feeling, which was present in previous Silent Hill games. IGN wrote that the separation between safe exploration and puzzling and running for your life for monster scenarios is just too transparent here, and as a result, you will inevitably come to fear the ice and very few other things. Eurogamer wrote that they created a welcome mix with no gameplay element overemphasized. A lot of people felt that the chase sequences were just way too frustrating or grew way too repetitive too quickly. A lot of people also praised the plot of the game and thought it was a lot easier to follow than the original. Game Informer drew comparisons with the film director M. Night Shyamalan's style. The game was, however, said to have a short length and that seemed to be one of the big drawbacks about the game. A lot of people wanted a lot more and it just ended up closing up way too soon. Though with the multiple endings, I guess there is some replay value, but not by much. The PSP version was said to be one of the best looking PSP games out there, and it did have a very detailed look. Although some said the controls were really sluggish, and that there was an inability to directly control and point the flashlight at things. And this was both said about the PSP and the PS2 versions. With it being designed for the Wii, it was obviously it being ported over, not everything translated smoothly. Overall, the game still did very well and it got a lot of praise for what it was. I liked it for what it was, and it did breathe a little bit of new life into the series, so I can appreciate it. The next game is an odd game. When you think about Silent Hill, you think about the horror elements. All the games always had some type of horror within them. It was about sitting in the dark room and playing a game all by yourself and hoping that Pyramid Head didn't come around the corner and kill you. Well, this game throws all that out the window. This game is Silent Hill the Arcade. Yep, there was an arcade version spin-off of the Silent Hill series. It was like how most arcade games were, pretty much an on-rails shoot-em-up. This is the farthest away you could possibly get from the Silent Hill games. Completely gone is anything you've come to know about Silent Hill, and get ready to blast monsters in the face. This game has Eric and Tina, who have entered the town of Silent Hill and must battle all the Silent Hill monsters to uncover the mystery behind Eric's nightmares. Think of it like the House of Dead arcade games, where you have to have the light gun and you have to aim and shoot at your enemies. It also has a multiplayer element where two people can be Eric and Tina. Players can drop in and out very easily as well. The game was given a negative review by Destructoid. They regarded it as an extremely unnecessary spin on the classic horror survival series, in which they are right. This game was not needed at all, and it completely makes no sense for the series that's based on puzzles, exploration, and combat. This just wasn't their style. The only elements of Silent Hill here are the town, the monsters, and the music. It just seems like they were trying to collect some more money off the Silent Hill fans. The game was actually worked on by a few members of the original Team Silent, alongside Konami's Japanese department. It was released in Japan of July of 2007, and a year later for Europe and Australia. It seems like America got no love in this. It uses music, locations, and monsters from Silent Hill 2, 3, and 4. A lot of people have never experienced this game because it's never been ported to a console or the PC, and the actual cabinets are pretty rare. However, in 2014, fans unofficially ported it to the PC, but it can only be ran at a low resolution. From what I can tell, the game revolves around Toluca Lake, which is Silent Hill's main attraction. This lake is, like, severely haunted, with many corpses resting at the bottom of it. From what I gather, there was an accident on a boat, and 14 people disappeared on the lake, and there were no survivors or bodies found from them. 70 years later, Eric and Tina and the other members of their university's occult club decided to head to Silent Hill for its many stories, particularly the one about Toluca Lake and all the bodies sleeping within the bottom of it. That sounds just like a great vacation, doesn't it? Soon they find out that one of their friends is injured and the others are completely vanished. So what do they do? Do they turn around and say screw it and get the hell out of there? No, of course not. They delve deeper into the haunted town to find themselves at the hospital. Soon, they hear the missing boat's foghorn from so many years ago. And what does this do? It brings out the other world, of course. So now they are in the other world, and they're at the hospital. And soon, they come to find Pyramid Head. Yay, he joined the party! And they have to fight him. They did some monster fighting, and then the world transitioned back to the normal one. The game has four endings overall. One including a joke ending, which at least they kept up with the spirit of the Silent Hill games. The game has alternate paths and routes that you can take that can provide stronger weapons such as shotguns and rifles. The alternate paths don't really offer much in substantial variation in the gameplay, it's just really to get better weapons. The game is divided up into chapters in order to better track your progress. Each chapter has stages in it, normally with a boss defeated at the end of the third stage. Most bosses had a time limit in which you had to defeat them within that time frame or your friend would be killed off. Note that not saving your friend will affect the overall outcome of the game, and it will also affect your grade. In Asia, there is a special amusement pass, which when it's used, it can include internet rankings, and it also allows you to skip stages that you've already played. So you can pretty much pick up where you left off in the game, which is a cool little feature if you're gonna go play it. Overall, the game was considered to be enjoyable as a classic shooter game, but definitely considered out of place for the Silent Hill games. If you don't look at it as a pure Silent Hill game, and instead look at it as a shooter, then it's a pretty alright game. It has the beating bloody heart of Silent Hill, with its familiarity of its locations, music, and monsters, and the otherworld transitions as well. But it's still just not Silent Hill in my opinion. Still a cool little game if you can find it. Next off is Silent Hill: The Escape. Now this game is a 2008 mobile game that was designed for the iPhone and iPod Touch. It's also another quite disconnect from the series as well, as it's a hybrid of a labyrinth game and a shooter game. The Escape is a simply designed shooting game in which the player has to walk through a labyrinth and try to escape. I mean, that's pretty much the premise of the whole game. I mean, it's in the title. Looking is done by tilting the device, and movement is done by sliding the finger around the screen. Turning is also limited to 90 degrees. The game uses the gyroscope in the device in order to look around at the current position. You have a revolver with 6 chambers in the gun, so after 6 shots, you have to reload. You also use the gyroscope to reload your gun by lining up the speed loader against the bullets. Doing it wrong is going to result in less ammo being replenished. All the monsters can take one hit if you hit them in their weak spot. The only monsters that take multiple hits are the ones that have moving shields to protect them, which are the Butcher and Pyramid Head. Once the bullet count reaches 0, you no longer have the ability to use your gun. Instead, you'll have a steel pipe in which you use the touchscreen to build up strength on the screen. The game will end once a monster gets to you. As far as I can tell, it was developed and published by Konami. And there really isn't much else about this game. It doesn't really have a story or anything like that, it's just pretty much an unnecessary thing. If you want to make some serious money on a Silent Hill mobile game, Bring an actual Silent Hill game with a story to the table with atmosphere and the horror that we all love. There's no reason why these days it cannot be done with all the technology that we have. The only issue I can really see with a Silent Hill game on mobile would be, it's not really designed for that. Silent Hill is more of a room in the dark sort of experience to me. But hell, if they could put every Five Nights at Freddy's game on a mobile device, why not Silent Hill? Next is also another bizarre iteration for the series. Silent Hill Book of Memories was published by Konami and developed by WayForward Technologies for the PlayStation Vita. The development began in summer of 2010, and the major guidelines for the game was the following. A Vita-centric Silent Hill, not traditional, and different every time you play it. The team making this game had a proof of concept for the PC produced in 2 months within the development. This concept used a third-person camera angle, much like you would see in the earlier life of the games. A prototype was being done mid-December of that same year, which used the Infernal Engine. The idea for the game was to have it play out like an isometric view for the puzzles, and then to switch over to an over-the-shoulder type of view for combat. But after throwing around the idea, they decided it was just way too complicated, because all of the assets would have to be created from two different perspectives. The game was announced in 2011 for the PlayStation Vita at E3, which I'm sure a lot of people were excited for because the last time we had a portable Silent Hill experience was on the PSP, which was 4 years earlier. The unique thing about Book of Memories was that it had the option for multiplayer. This was a first for the series. Silent Hill 8 was originally playing around with the idea of multiplayer, but it was deemed far too out of place for the series. Rightfully so, because Silent Hill was supposed to be you versus the dark and the unknown within it. Not you and Bob versus the darkness. Adding Bob to the mix just made it less personal and scary. So now you are probably thinking, what kind of game is this? You know what though? It gets even weirder. This game ended up becoming an RPG with an overhead perspective as you played through the monster-filled dungeons. Diablo, anyone? You can choose from 5 character classes, which are Bookworm, Goth, Jock, Preppy, and the Rocker, and you could customize them to a little bit of an extent. The player receives XP for defeating monsters, and after you have enough XP, you can level them up and improve your stats. You could also loot items to improve your stats as well. The goal of each zone was to collect the required amount of puzzle pieces to solve that area's puzzle, and then move on to the next. Each zone had a shop and a save point, and each zone also had the option of a side quest at the very beginning of each one. You of course can loot a number of weapons that are both melee and ranged in nature along with ammo. Weapons can degrade and break over time though, but they can also be repaired. At the beginning of the game, you can only carry 2 weapons at a time. Additionally, the game features an alignment system in which you collect karma from monsters, and it can shift the character's alignment towards either light or blood, depending on the monster. Each alignment has different abilities and certainly affects the end of the game. There are many creatures from the other Silent Hill games present in this one, like the Ghost from 4 and Pyramid Head from 2. The game has a story in which the main character finds this book that they know nothing about on their birthday. And it's known as, you guessed it, the Book of Memories. It is revealed that the main character's entire life is written in the pages, and that if they change the texts within, the outcome of their life will change accordingly. The main character uses the power of the book to attempt to change their life, but there are often unforeseen and unfavorable consequences, and guess what happened? Bad things, that's what happened. Now at this point, this sounds just quite bizarre for Silent Hill, doesn't it? It definitely does to me. It's right up there with the arcade game. So now you're probably asking, well, how did it do? Was it any good? Well, in 2012, it finally released, and it became the 4th best-selling game on the Vita. It certainly did a lot better than I thought it would. I mean, most probably picked it up because they were fans of the Silent Hill series. They probably didn't really know what they were getting. The game got a 58 out of 100 on Metacritic, and there were a lot of mixed feelings about the game. The official PlayStation magazine said that it felt odd, as though Diablo has murdered Silent Hill and is traipsing around wearing its skin. Greg Miller of IGN said, "If you just want dungeons to crawl through and couldn't care less about a polished menu or engaging story, great. Everyone else, don't feel bad to skip it." Hardcore Gamer's Steve Hanley enjoyed the game and said, "While survival horror purists may balk at the concept, Anyone that is a fan of top-down action RPGs, some deep gameplay and interesting story will not only find that, but also find that it's the most addicting multiplayer Vita game to date, but also the best Silent Hill game in recent memory. There was also a lot of mixed opinions about the story. Most thought the game was pretty light on it, but there was still something behind your character doing what he was doing at least. IGN said that the plot was nonsensical and badly executed, while GamesRadar said that they enjoyed the story and writing, and the game itself wasn't that scary, but what the character doing changing his past at the expense of others is quite twisted. Overall, this game is really bizarre looking and certainly feels different, but it seemed to have turned out alright. I would say it's probably best if you don't look at it as a Silent Hill game, or anything that adds to the series, because it really doesn't add anything. If you are looking for a good dungeon crawler on the Vita, this certainly is a good option and you can't really go wrong with it. So, we have essentially looked at every Silent Hill thing except for one. The HD Collection. God oh god, the HD Collection. Sit down and let me tell you a truly horrible tale. One that belongs straight in Silent Hill. A game that isn't really that great of a remastered collection, and you would probably just be better off playing the PC ones. So anyways, Silent Hill the HD Collection. It had a 720p resolution at 30 frames per second. The games were also redubbed with brand new voice acting, but you can switch back to the old voice work in Silent Hill 2 if you want to. But Silent Hill 3, you have to switch to the new voice work, mainly because Silent Hill 3 lacked the original ones. Konami messed up big time. There was a lot more work to be redone because of the fact that Konami lost the source code. Yeah, they lost the source code for their own games. How does this happen? How do you lose something like that? So Konami had to give the team working on the project, which was Hijinx Studio, an unfinished beta build of each game for the final version. What did this cause? It caused a ton of severe technical issues, and it made the collection one of the worst HD collections ever made. They also had to redub voices because Guy Sihi requested residuals for the multiple ports and re-releases of Silent Hill 2, as he claimed to have owned the rights to James's voice and motion capture. It was refuted and it was just a big mess. Guy Sihi also stated that it wasn't about the money, it was more about the thoughtless way that those involved in the production was treated. With it being Konami, I would definitely believe, as Konami has been known to be dicks. Also, they had to do redubs for the third game anyway, since it lacked the original voice work for some reason. I'm guessing Konami lost that too. Eventually though, the voice actors, including Guy Sihi, all signed a waiver saying that their voices could be reused. So, the option was thrown in to use the original voice work if you wanted it. It's worth noting that all the voice actors signed the waiver because they did it for the fans, not Konami. There were a lot of little changes to the game, and I will go through them now. Here is all the stuff they changed in Silent Hill 2. First off, the characters tend to say new words at the beginning of a sentence. I don't really know why they do this, but they do. Maybe it was perhaps to give a new feel to the game. During the opening monologue of 2, it had a guitar in it, but it was changed from acoustic to electric. Again, I don't really understand the change, but maybe it was because they were going for a different feel, were trying to be grungier or something. The distance on the sign at the beginning of 2 had been changed. Originally, it said Paleville was 10 miles, Old Silent Hill was 50 miles, and that Brahms was 265 miles away. Now in the HD collection, the signs say 9, 6, and 16 miles instead. Maybe they lost the original sign assets or something. I'm guessing a lot of assets were either missing or incomplete and had to be completely redone. Thanks, Konami. Another thing that was in there was the Silent Hill Ranch signs. The font was changed to Comic Sans. Who the hell uses Comic Sans? For anything. Some things I can understand, such as textures on the first aid kits and medical cross posters. Some things just needed an HD upgrade. But also, the streets and sidewalk textures were changed to give off a more cleaner look. The thing about that is, Silent Hill should never have a clean look to it. I can understand some things getting redone for the sake of an upgrade, but Silent Hill shouldn't look clean. It should not have clean textures. It's a decaying, nightmarish atmosphere for a reason. Another thing was some simple grammar mistakes in Eddie's rant in the labyrinth. One of the big changes I see is the Sutherland's videotape. It's now bordered instead of full screen. This can make a really important part seem hard to notice. The FMV sequences are also stretched to give a widescreen appearance to them. This is more problematic in 2 than it was 3 because 2 is a lot more FMV heavy. This will slightly give a stretched look to the characters, which make them look a little bit off. 3 has a number of changes too, including saving the game at a halo of the run makes it fade to white instead of red. Also, all of the music had been reworked and changed. The most noted part was the Otherworld Mall, in which the ambient music had been changed to punk rock style. When Heather meets Claudia, you can hear a baby crying in the background, and you can also hear the game over sound in the background of the cutscene. In the intro, you can see someone bending over to drag someone to a lake, but it was changed probably mainly due to the scene not being in HD. There were some script changes as well that they improved on, but despite the changes, the subtitles still have the old script. Because of the lack of letterboxing, there was a quick 1 second shot of Heather's skirt where her vest is seen through. Also, during the Leonard Wolf boss fight, Heather and Leonard are both able to sprint full speed into the water as if the water wasn't even there. Another thing is when Heather returns to Douglas Carter after the final boss, his coat is noticeably much bloodier than it was in the original, and there isn't really any reason for it. I don't really understand why it's there, it doesn't make any sense. But oh well, it's also worth noting that 14 of Heather's costumes from the PS2 version were removed, probably due to the copyright issues with logos and licensing. There is also a very long list of technical issues and glitches within the game, which I know you guys would love to know, so I'm going to go through them now. Please note that some of these are actually fixed on the PS3 version, but a lot of them still aren't. For one, the entire game crashes and freezes up sometimes when you enter a new area. It just means it crashes all the time. This seems to be more common in Silent Hill 3 than it was in 2. Also, there is entire rooms that just do not seem to load at all, and instead, you glitch out in an inescapable void. You can still move around and hear footsteps, but essentially the game is now broken. It seems to only happen in Silent Hill 2 at the apartment complex and the hospital. There are also lots of lag and framerate drops all over the place, and even lag when you get a trophy or achievement. There are lots and lots of graphical glitches such as horrible lighting. There are even sound loops and audio glitches. Hell, there is even some areas of audio that just are completely missing altogether. Sometimes the background audio would just stop for no reason at all, and it wasn't to build up tension, it just stopped for no reason. Also, the sound of the submachine gun was glitched. There was also some complaints about the reduction of fog, glass, and shadows, which were a huge complaint. There was a ton of fog in the original games, sometimes to cover up messed up stuff, such as incomplete backgrounds. Well, it looks like they just didn't add enough fog to the HD collection. It makes the game just look completely bad and incomplete, which it was incomplete. There were missing shadows, especially on the characters, and the game had moments where it was just being way too dark, even at maxed out brightness, it just looked way completely washed out. The depth of field was also very glitched out. There were blurry scenes where there shouldn't be, and non-blurry scenes where there should have been. Also having extremely pixelated shadows when shadows actually showed up. There's also a ton of inaccurate textures going on, such as the elevator having the floor's texture for some reason, which was found in the 360 version of the game. And also this seriously messed up and misplaced texture on this character. Now just gaze upon it for a second. I know that Silent Hill has monstrosities and things that go wrong, but this shouldn't be happening. Great Jesus, why? There is also a very serious glitch where when you get an achievement unlocked, the entire game freezes up, and it seems to be exclusive for the Xbox 360 version of Silent Hill 3. Maria's jail cell scene can be completely glitched out if you have picked up the Great Knife. Some issues specific to the PS3 version was erratic walking speed, which, at its worst, can just completely break the game and make it unplayable. Also, there was a problem with the game running before the load screens are even done, which means you could take damage before the loading screen is even off the screen. Or you can completely miss the first bits of a cutscene, which could be important. A day one patch was released for the PS3, but many people said it straight up did absolutely nothing. No difference at all. Lovely. Then there was another patch released on the PS3, and it fixed a number of problems such as the framerate drops and the lip sync, which was greatly improved upon. Missing sound and music also had been fixed alongside the fog density issues. there were other minor visual and audio problems that were improved upon as well. That's great and all, until I read that there was absolutely no patch for the 360 version. No patch at all. Are you kidding me? All those issues that I read off earlier. Some which are really, really big issues. I mean issues that break the game kind of issues. There was no patch for. It was said due to technical issues and resources, making any attempt at resolving the problems was ineffective. What? What the hell does that even mean? It means in short term that Konami messed up big time and they were not gonna fix it. It means that they didn't want to spend any more time and any more money on this game. They already made their cash. They were not gonna fix the problems, obviously. It also means they shouldn't have lost the original games in the first place. I still can't comprehend how you lose two whole finished games. How the hell does this even happen? Why even sell a broken game in the first place? Why would you do that to the fans that supported you for years and years, and absolutely adored your series? And the better question is, why would there be no patch support for the 360 version? With all these game-breaking things I listed, why are they still selling this game? I guess if there is a silver lining on the situation, it would be that Konami chose to compensate people that bought the 360 version of it by offering them another game or even a PS3 version of the game. But still, why is this a thing? The product should be completely discontinued and pulled from the shelves. And they shouldn't collect another dime for this version of the game. What gives Konami the right to keep that crap out there and keep selling a broken game which they did not fix? I don't even understand it and it just pisses me off. I understand they try to compensate people, but there are many people that don't even know they're buying a broken game. And they don't even know they can get compensation for it. Not everyone is as informed as you and me. Maybe you didn't even know it was a mess. I surely didn't know it was this messed up. I know it had its problems because there was an overwhelming amount of complaints in the beginning. But this is just ridiculous. The more research I did on this just made my blood boil. That a company would do this to their loyal fans. Then again, Konami doesn't really have a good track record on listening to their fans in the first place. It's sad and unfortunate, really. If you want a more HD experience, get the PC version. Don't waste your time on this crappy collection. I know it seems like we have been through everything, but we so have not been. I'm going to go through all the cancelled games that I could find online. Apparently some games were just not meant to be, and their lives were seized before they even had a chance to become a realization. First off, we're going to talk about WayForward Technologies, yes, the ones that made the Vita Silent Hill Book of Memories game. They were also working on a series installment for the DS in 2006. They developed a one-room prototype demo using the lead character and assets from Silent Hill 2, but that was all that came from it. Before any more could be done with the game, it was cancelled. It was supposed to be a much more traditional approach to the Silent Hill games than Book of Memories was. This was also interesting if you look up the prototype for Book of Memories, because the Book of Memories actually started out as a very different game than what it ended up being. But yeah, this is pretty much all I could find on the project. There was not much more known about it. So moving on. Renegade Kid pitched their DS title, Dementium: The Word, as a Silent Hill spin-off. Now, I don't know if everyone knows what Dementium: The Word is, but it was a really creepy game based in a hospital. I could definitely see it being a Silent Hill title, but Konami rejected it. Konami rejected it on the basis that they did not trust a small company to work with the license. Renegade Kid also later pitched a modified version of Dementium 2, which was also rejected. But this time it was because Konami did not want to release a horror game on the DS. I don't understand why they didn't want to work with a smaller company in the first place, because they picked a relatively new company to do all the work for the HD collection, and boy did that thing need a lot of work. They trusted two incomplete versions of their games with a rather new company like Hijinx Studios. So what was the issue with Renegade Kid? Oh well, just another something not to be. Dementium 1 and 2 were not bad games at all either. Silicon Knights, a video game developer struggling financially after a long court battle with Epic Games, announced all their titles that were currently in production when the company ceased development in 2012. One of the games on that list was Silent Hill: The Box, but later it became known as only The Box. There wasn't really much known about the game except for a few screenshots I could find online. and it was also known to be an open-world survival horror game for the PS3 and 360. When I was doing my research for the game, I also found out that Konami might not have even known about the project's existence. It was probably a game that Silicon Knights was gonna pitch to Konami, but it ended up not happening because the company closed. Well, now we'll never know what it could have been. I mean, an open-world survival horror game does not sound bad in the same vein as a Silent Hill game. I would have really liked to have seen at least more information about it. Eventually, THQ picked up the game, and they renamed it The Ritualist, and it was a whole new different game, but ultimately it was completely canned altogether. Silent Hill Cold Hearts is the most substantial game I could find that was cancelled. It was pitched as a new Silent Hill game to Konami, and it would have followed Jessica Chambers as the protagonist, as she talked to the psychiatrist about not being able to sleep due to nightmares that she was having. This all led to Jessica leaving her college town and heading back home to see her family. But she was caught in a blizzard, but no worries, she's just gonna follow an ambulance to a random town. That random town ends up being Silent Hill. Thank you, ambulance. This pretty much would have been where the game picked up. It would have used elements we all know and love from the Silent Hill games, but it would have also had some Wii remote mechanics, because it would have been a Wii game. In combat, you would have swung your Wii remote around to deal with on-screen actions. The remote was also going to be used for puzzles within the game. It was also going to allow you to use the Wii remote to point, shake, and nod your head while interacting with the other characters, which sounded pretty cool. It was called the first real psychological horror game, as described when it was pitched to Konami. The game would have individually tailored itself to the player and make it their own experience. Depending on the individual, there would be different story events, dialogue, sound cues, monsters, and even a camera field of view would be different. And it would all change to tailor your own experience with the game. That actually sounds pretty awesome to me. It was also planned to have a dynamic weather system, in which it would have had an updated fog system to react to different objects around the environment. And also blizzards would have had different intensities to make the player react to them. Climax Studios was going to work on this game, and they really wanted it to be seamless in transition. They wanted absolutely no load times. They were going to stream the content ahead of the player by anticipating where the player would go. This would have meant no loading times, or at least very little, which is what the team wanted. They also wanted to do photorealistic graphics, and they were pretty confident that they could achieve this. They really wanted to change people's minds on what could push the Wii's graphics. The game's vision was, however, never realized, but a few of the ideas were in shattered memories, so it's not a total loss. The harsh coldness of the environments and the psychological profiling to change the game was added to Shattered Memories, and it really helped shape that game up from what it was. I just can't help wonder what Cold Heart could have been, if it would have ever came to fruition. It didn't sound like a bad idea of a concept. Unfortunately, a lot of cool ideas just lay down on the development table and are never seen again. Maybe someday though. Lastly, we're gonna look at Silent Hills, also known as PT. This was probably the most famous cancelled Silent Hill game that there was to date, and the most recent as well, and an open wound for fans of the series. The game was a survival horror game that was under development by Kojima Productions for the PlayStation 4, and it was to be directed by Hideo Kojima and Guillermo del Toro, and it was going to officially be the 9th installment in the series. Kojima was brought onto the project in 2012 by Konami, and it was officially announced in August of 2014 by the demo PT, which was short for Playable Teaser. The demo was released free on the PlayStation Store and was available to everyone. People had lost their minds over this game, saying it was the scariest thing they have ever played. It felt like a return to true horror, and it also felt like a return to Silent Hill in a much different way. It had a very different tone and approach to the series than the last games. It was also announced that Del Toro and Norman Reedus were also involved with the production of the game, with Del Toro helping direct alongside Hideo Kojima, and Norman Reedus was providing his voice and likeness in the appearance of the protagonist. At this point, people were really getting hyped up for the game. Everyone wanted to see more. The game's development, however, was questioned due to the rumors of Kojima's work with the completion of Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain, and also his eventual exit and cutting ties with Konami altogether. In April 2005, reports surfaced from Del Toro that the Silent Hills project was cancelled and Konami officially confirmed it a short time later. This move was greatly negatively received by the fans and critics alike, and that's an understatement, guys. The playable teaser used a first-person camera perspective, which was a departure from the series, but it still impressed everyone. It centered around an unknown protagonist who awakens in this mysterious, messed-up house. The only thing you can really do is walk around and zoom in to explore different things, and it's just pretty much a loop in the same corridor over and over again. But each time you loop, it gets more messed up, and things start to slowly change and twist, and it dives you into a madness. After solving the final puzzle of the demo, it was revealed as a new Silent Hill game directed by Hideo Kojima and Del Toro, with the protagonist being portrayed as Norman Reedus. At this point, people were so happy and they could barely contain it. They couldn't wait for more information about the game. Most thought this was exactly what the series needed. At the Tokyo Game Show in September 2014, Sony revealed that PT had actually been downloaded over a million times. It received so much praise from everyone. Everyone seriously was pumped up for this game. Then the news started to trickle out, and reports had said that Kojima and his senior staff was planning on leaving Konami following the completion of Metal Gear Solid 5. Konami also announced a restructuring of its video game business. It soon removed references to Kojima and Kojima's productions and its promotional materials for its games. However, a Konami spokesperson was denying that Kojima was going to leave the company, and stated he would still be involved with Konami after the Metal Gear Solid franchise. Later on at the San Francisco Film Society event on April 26, 2015, Assistant Director Del Toro reportedly told attendees that Silent Hills has been cancelled. The very next day, Norman Reedus had the same exact thing to say on Twitter. That same day, Konami announced that they would be pulling the PT demo on the 29th on the PlayStation Store. Konami later issued a statement confirming that Silent Hills was not going to be continued, but that they still planned on working with the Silent Hill franchise. Fans were outraged, rightfully so, and they started a petition online asking Konami to continue the game. The game had so much potential, but Konami just messed it up once again, as the same they've been doing for years now. And now there are no more Silent Hill projects on the horizon. Maybe they'll do a pinball machine. Or a mobile game perhaps, since they seem to be on board with that. It just seems to be what they're into these days, and that's kinda sad. So many awesome games had to suffer in the process. The story, however, ends well for Kojima, in the matter that he landed on his feet just fine. During E3 this year, he announced Death Stranding, which was also going to feature Norman Reedus. Even though it's not Silent Hill, it's Kojima pretty much showing the world that Konami cannot keep him down. They can be dicks all they want, but they can't keep him down. You go, Kojima, with your whale Norman Reedus fetus-loving self. Overall, Silent Hill now feels mostly dead. It doesn't mean it is, but right now, after everything that has happened with it, it just feels like for the first time, it just feels like it's gone. This isn't the first time that Konami has screwed fans over their beloved franchises. But I'm glad we could take this scary, horrific journey together. And even though it didn't end on a good note, you never know. Silent Hill could be lurking in the shadows just waiting for a chance to make a return. It's hard telling at this point. But I still loved taking a look back at all the games, and even taking a look at some of the ones I didn't really know about that well. I liked looking at the weird and bizarre games in the series. It was truly a wild ride, guys. And if this video gets some likes, I may even do a playthrough of the Silent Hill games myself on this channel. We might just have a Silent Hill-a-thon, perhaps. So thanks for watching, guys. I know this was a very long Halloween special, but I at least hope it was informative for you, and it let you know some things about Silent Hill that perhaps you did not know before. It is Halloween, and I did want to put together a special video for you guys. I just hope this was special enough. I spent so much time, and I spent weeks on this. I wanted to show you guys a series of games that were perfect to play on Halloween. I'm definitely gonna pop in Silent Hill 2 and play a little bit of it. I hope you all enjoy your spooky holiday, and if you like this video, please subscribe to this content to see more videos like this. I definitely want to make more in the same vein of this kind. It was a lot of work, but also a lot of fun. So thanks for watching, guys. You have a spooky day or a spooky night, and don't eat too much candy. Good night, guys.